organize the committee for allowing me and inviting me to speak in Chicago on the PRP. PRP was first brought to the limelight when Tiger Woods published saying that he took PRP for his sports injury and recommends it. That's what got the ball rolling and got many physicians and many patients also asking for PRP and physicians doing PRP. After coming to this conference, I think many of us here are already doing PRP. So I was kind of thinking, what should I talk about? Once when I went to a wedding, this was a wedding of my friend. He was getting married for the 7th time. Yeah, 7th time. So when he went to reply to the toast, he said, "I know what I have to do tonight, but my only problem is how to make it interesting." So I think I know what we have to do about PRP, but the problem is how to make PRP interesting. Okay, so coming back, this is a sketch of a face. If you draw a line, you can see the lines are smooth. And as a person ages, you can see the lines have certain bumps, the lines have certain wrinkles inside. As we learned in facial aesthetics, the most important golden rule is move the wrinkles or move the scars towards the RSTLs and play with the way light reflects off a face. Because facial aesthetics is basically the reflection of light off a face. So if you play with it by pulling the skin up, getting the scars wherever they have to be in the proper RSTLs, and the light reflects well, you don't see the scars, you don't see the wrinkles. So what is PRP or PRP lysate or this new word? If you want to know, you need to buy my book. Okay. So PRP stands for platelet-rich plasma, and this platelet-rich plasma contains a lot of growth factors, vascular endothelial growth factors, TGF-beta, IGF-1, etc. A lot of things that are inside the platelet that help basically angiogenesis. If you see here, we have classified some of the growth factors that have been isolated from PRP and their function. Now, this is a very important slide. This shows that when a tissue is insult, when tissue insult is happening or there is tissue injury, first you have hemostasis, you have inflammation, you have regeneration, and then you have remodeling. This is very important in any kind of regenerative medicine or regenerative procedures. What we try to do, whether we do it with a laser, whether do we do it with a peel, whether we do it with any other methods. So coming back to PRP, it jumpstarts the healing process. It increases the growth factor level at the site of the injury. This also has a lot of anti-inflammatory properties. This is a very simple method of preparing PRP. You draw the blood, you centrifuge it, you see there are three layers. The platelet poor plasma on top, then you have the platelet rich plasma, then you have the buffy coat, and you have the RBCs. So you take off the platelet rich plasma and you just inject it in the face. You can inject it in the joints. You can inject it wherever you want new blood vessels or angiogenesis to be present. So some of the cosmetic indications of PRP, we have it for anti-aging, face wrinkles, neck wrinkles, hand wrinkles, nasal labials, acne mark, acne scars, under eye bags, loose or saggy skin. We also use it for what you call it, inject it into the clitoris for G-spot enhancement. And we have orthopedic indications where we use it for a lot of tennis elbows. We use it for plantar fasciitis, osteoarthritis. We get good results for osteoarthritis. So rotator cuff disease, whenever basically you want repair to start. So you can see there have been studies published, or rather this is the first study published in 2010 in the American Journal of Physical Medicine, followed by studies published in Europe. And today PRP is being used a lot. So again, we come back to the same slide, some advantages of PRP. Coming to the platelet structure. You see the platelet is a closed structure. The stuff inside over here is full of growth factors. This is the stuff that actually works. This is the stuff that contains the vascular endothelial growth factors that we want to be active on the cell site. Again, this is the size and volume of a platelet. It's usually 12.8 femoliter and 2.9 nanometer in diameter. What if we could get the stuff from inside the platelet out and concentrate that and use it? Because when you inject whole platelets, many a time a lot of them are reabsorbed by the body and they do not get optimal effect on the site, and you do not get optimal growth factors over there. So what if you could take this out and inject only that stuff over there? That would enhance the healing process much faster. So what we did is that we used to do the PRP, then we would freeze and thaw cycles, would break the platelets. We would filter it and we would collect something called human platelet lysate or PRP2X. This could be frozen and this could be used. But this entire process needs a lab, needs a clean room, and it needs a lot of expertise of handling the stuff. If you're not trained, it's difficult. Pipetting out certain, only the platelets and all that. So we developed an innovation where we have 12 arcs, and each of these arcs have 12 concentric circles. Inside this device, there is a micropore filter, 12 micropore filters in each of these. And if you see, the space keeps on decreasing. So your PRP comes out over here, the platelet lyse, and it's collected in the syringe. So it's a simple device which can be used in the clinic. You don't need any high-end instruments, you don't need any high-end centrifuges costing $10,000, $20,000. You don't need that high-end investment. So this is how it is. You just centrifuge the blood, the one which we showed you. Just take it in a syringe, pass it through the device, and you see this color has changed, the texture has changed. This contains a lot of growth factors. This can be quantified by mass atomic spectrometry. Now coming to the injection technique, this is basically a diagram of the RSTLs. You can inject over here, and sometimes you use it with Botox, with fillers, you get a good result if you want to combine PRP. Because in aesthetics, there is no single magic bullet. Combination is the key. If you want to achieve your goal, having two or three procedures combined together is really good. We can see we have done over here, this is a 3-month follow-up. Again, we use it for the neck rejuvenation. This lady, we have done fat. Along with fat graft, we have also put PRP. And we have found that fat with PRP increases the viability of the fat cells over there, the lysate, the PRP lysate, because that's the growth factors that come out from the platelets. Again, we use it for under eye. A lot of under eye patients we've done. You can see the filling effect has happened. Some collagen neogenesis is taking place. This is a full face with PRP. Stretch marks We do it for stretch marks. Now, a lot of people ask me, do stretch marks go? That's a vague question. Because stretch marks need to be classified. There are four classifications of stretch marks. Class 1 to 4. If we class 1 to 3 do get better, class 1 and 2 can disappear. But class 4 stretch marks do not. For hair, this conference, unfortunately, is cosmetology and trichology, but we have very few presenters on hair. So I think I would like to touch up a little bit. Male pattern baldness, to some extent, can be treated. But this is very important. Of course, there's a lot of light shining here, so it cannot be seen clearly. PRP is not magic. You can't grow new hair with PRP because a hair follicle is a pilosebaceous unit. So before doing any procedure for the hair, we always do a dermatoscopy and we see the viable hair follicles. If there are viable hair follicles, we go ahead with the PRP lysate because that brings more blood supply that causes maybe from one follicle, two or three hairs to sprout. But if the patient has totally dead follicles, you can see white fibrous rings and there are no follicles, no matter how much PRP you do, no matter whatever you do, you are never going to sprout hair over there. In such patients, the only thing to do is a hair transplant. Post-transplant or pre-transplant, you can do PRP lysate to increase the vascularity so that the amount of hair transplanted do not fall. And you have a higher success rate because whenever you transplant, you take off the hair, especially in follicular transplant unit. You take off one and put one. Or you can do the strip method. You have a lot of fallout rate because there is not much blood supply. There is shock to the hair follicle. So to decrease that, we put PRP. So over there you have angiogenesis taking place. That angiogenesis prepares the bed and so the hair sticks and starts to grow. So again, this is only PRP. This was plain PRP, we used it for wound healing. Now, sometimes in wound healing or chronic wounds, we would add maybe 2 units of human growth hormone. I know this is a very touchy subject in the United States, but we do add two or three units of human growth hormone for wounds. That would, you know, inhibit the tissue contact factors. So the skin starts to grow faster. So it also can be used for wound healing, fractures, I mean, intraoperative use. There was one patient which we have treated who had avascular necrosis of the femur. She came to us saying that she couldn't sit, she did not want to go for an operation. She knew she had a diagnosis of avascular necrosis of the femur. She had visited many orthopedic surgeons. She had an MRIs, so I said, see, you need to go for surgery. But she said, no, I do not want to go for surgery. So I told her we can try PRP. We did a CT guided injection of PRP on the joint. She is better. Of course, she's not cured. She will never be cured. But her symptoms are better and she's kind of happy. So advantage of PRP 2X or platelet lysate over the plain PRP, you have a higher concentrations of growth factor. You can store it up to 6 months once you prepare it in liquid nitrogen. It has to be stored in liquid nitrogen, otherwise it starts to degenerate. And every time you use it, you need to thaw it. But you need not store it. You can prepare it every time, inject it, and it's over. But for some people, in case you need to store it, you can. Some contraindications, platelet dysfunction syndrome, clinical thrombocytopenia, malignancy, sepsis. Autoimmune disease is a question mark because we don't know if it actually helps in autoimmune disease, PRP, or would make the inflammation worse. We actually don't know. So these are some bibliographies, some literatures taken from PubMed about PRP. So now I don't think you need to buy the book. Any questions?